Mittag. Willkommen wieder. Das ist die Agenda für meinen Talk. Ist etwas. Ja. So? Schön. Okay. Lassen wir anfangen mit beim Beginn. Who am I? I'm Gabi Schilders, and I'm well aware that Gabi is a girl's name in Germany. I hope I didn't disappoint anyone. I hope the talk may work for in my advantage then. I'll be doing the talk in English though, because my German isn't good enough to do the whole talk in German. I don't think that should be a problem, but if there is something that is unclear, do not hesitate to ask, please. Right? So, I'm a sales engineer, which means that I assist my colleagues in architecture and design. It also means that I am very capable of making a lot out of very little, and you'll see that later on. I've been an open source user since 92, and you can blame open source for that. It's been the mainstay of my career, and the reason was that 25 years back, almost to the day, I was in a lecture room like this in Amsterdam at the VU, sitting in your place, listening to Andrew Tannenbaum, my professor there. He's a rather well-known computer scientist. And he was telling us, students, that back then that monolithic kernels were dead. They were going the way of the dodo. There would be no more of those, and everything would become microkernel. Almost at the same time, just a few months later, one of my fellow students pointed me to Linux so that I can practice my Unix skills at home. And, well, we all know what came of the prediction of Andrew Tannenbaum. There's two lessons in there, and one is don't always listen to your professor. He might be wrong, okay? Robert has just left the room, so I can say that now. But what it comes down to, if a professor who is very good in his field tells you that something can be done, he's usually right. If he says that something cannot be done or shouldn't be done, he might just be wrong. So please remember that. Because Linux has come a long way in the 25 years that I've worked with it. And I've worked with it all that time, either in my career as a tool or the product that I worked with or for. So we're here now. Of the top 500 supercomputers in the world, 498 run Linux. So that at approximation, the other two approach 0%. But that's not the only thing that Linux is used for nowadays. The internet runs on open source, all the infrastructure. Routers, DNS services. There's very little that doesn't somewhere run on Linux. And if you make it a bit wider and look at open source, then you all have a phone in your pocket, except the one stranger that has a Windows phone, of course, but most of you have either an iPhone or an Android phone, and that underneath is open source software at the basis. The same goes for your TVs, your ebook readers, almost everything that you touch right now that has embedded software has open source software in it. So, when I started with Linux, until just 7 years ago, if you mentioned open source software, there were managers in companies and they were looking at you, really? Software by hippies? And yeah, you weren't really taken serious. Except that they didn't know that the software was all running already running in their companies, but nobody told them. How the times have changed. Just 5 years ago, I was thinking of getting out of the Linux business altogether and doing something different, because I didn't see the change coming. And then suddenly, it did happen. Nowadays, if you look at who is earning money with Linux or with open source software in general, well, these guys, you all know, and yes, Microsoft is in there right now, making money of it, very good. But so does Apple, not very popular with open source people, but still, the operating system underneath is based on BSD. All Android devices and so many more. So then there's us, EDB Postgres. But I'll get back to that later. Because when I started at the university using Linux at home and using the computer system at the university, it was a system that used X server terminals, so basically thin clients, and server-based computing, where the server was a Motorola 68030, and yes, that's the same processor used in the Amiga computers from back then. So we saw that wave going up and down from thin clients, where the computers at home became ever more powerful, and the workload was shifted to the computer in your home or at your workplace, and back again. So server-based computing came up and went and came up and went, and we're now at another part where, even though this phone in my pocket is more powerful in all senses than a computer from just 10 years ago, 15 years ago, right? It's still considered a thin client, because all the stuff that you do with it, all the stuff that you do with apps may be processed locally, but all the data is somewhere in cloud computers. And if you do a search on Google, the search is still done on their computers. But what did happen is that we are now also entering a new era. And that era is an era where many of the computing devices that you'll be responsible for in the future are Internet of Things devices. Very small pieces of hardware, barely perceptible in your environment, right? Non-computer people will not even notice them in many cases, but they're there. And they produce data. And we're talking about mountains of data, right? The amount of data generated in the past few years is bigger than all the data that came before it. So it's an exponential growth. Part of your jobs will be to be responsible for keeping that data secure, but also for keeping people secure and making sure that that data is used wisely in all types of situations, both in business as in government and, in, for instance, in medical appliances. So this whole revolution was actually made possible by open source software, right? All this stuff that you use at home wouldn't be there, wouldn't be where it is now, if there wouldn't be open source software. So it required all kinds of new technologies, and these new technologies, they were created based on open source software on the simple reason that it was cheaper for the companies, and that's the whole aspect of business, of course. It was cheaper for them to take technologies that were already there and improve on them. So, and if they published the code, others could improve upon it as well. And this benefited the companies. But part of it was the company's responsibility in the end anyway. And that is where Google and others made their money. But it's your responsibility, because the cloud doesn't exist, right? The cloud is just somebody else's computer. So in the end, you can't just say, oh, it's a cloud application, it's not my responsibility, I only use it. You will be responsible in the end as computer scientists. Which brings me to a quick interlude, because data can be stored in many ways, and as I'll get back to later, structured method of storing data is something that I think you've been taught about. You've learned SQL in college. How many of you are using databases? All of you. Relational databases? Also. Other types of databases like NoSQL, Graph. Okay, quite a few. Do you understand the principles of relational databases? Because people use them and they can use SQL, but the thing is that relational databases have a very specific area of interest, and they offer you guarantees that other methods of data storage don't offer. So even if you're already familiar with it, I'll quickly go over them. Most, if not all, relational databases use SQL as their query language. There used to be other languages, but SQL evolved out of it, and it's now the de facto standard. And a relational database isn't relational if it doesn't do ACID. And although I think LSD was developed in the country next door, this isn't the same, ACID. Atomicity, there is no try. Either a transaction works or it doesn't work, but there is nothing in between. So either you tell the database, store my data, and it says, okay, I got it. Or it tells you, sorry, can't do it. But there is no in between. Atomicity guarantees exactly that. Consistency. Data is always valid according to the model. So if you tell the database, my data should look like this, it will guard it for you. And it will make certain that nobody can break those guarantees about the relations. Isolation. If two clients are trying to do a transaction, they can't look at each other's results while the transactions are still running. No peeking on the test. And durability means that if it's in there, it stays in there until you remove it again. So what is different in NoSQL databases? And the reason I'm talking about NoSQL databases is because they are the most widely used in cloud environments, right? And this is about cloud today. No standard query language. Many have a layer on top that emulates SQL, but it's not SQL, and it doesn't give the same guarantees. No query optimizer, no data normalization, no joins, no referential integrity, no durability. These are all hallmarks of relational databases. And as relational databases give these guarantees, they are needed for certain jobs. So the jobs that are put in NoSQL databases do not need this, right? So that's an awful lot of no's for NoSQL. But as I said, people still use it for lots of applications. And these applications, they have all kinds of properties that don't require a relational database. The trouble is that many applications do need relational guarantees for some part of their data, right? If you put a post on a timeline in Facebook, it doesn't really matter if, at one point, somebody responds to a post before or after one other person. If they create this, an update in reaction to the original post, there's no issue. They both respond to something before them. Trouble comes if you tried to exclude somebody and you told Facebook, no, they're not my friend anymore, because you didn't want them to see a certain update, but that message didn't get across from Europe to America, and they did get to see the update that you posted. That might be a real problem, right? So even though you don't need the guarantees for all data, the trouble with NoSQL is that if you're a developer and you only have a NoSQL database, your life becomes a lot harder because you as an application programmer will need to provide the certainty to the end user that data stays relationally integer. And that brings us to the subtitle of this talk, which is the CAP theorem, and why it's important for you people to know about it. Has any of you been taught about the CAP theorem? No? Okay. CAP theorem is made by Mr. Brewer, and what he stated was if you have consistency, availability, and partitioning, you can have only two of those, right? And, it's the same as fast, cheap, good, pick any two. This works in the same way, except that the three parties are different. Partitioning means that if you have a cluster of nodes managing data, that if there's a break in the communication between the nodes, the system is partitioned. That's the definition of it. So you can only guarantee both availability and consistency if there is no partition. That's what this theory states. And that is important for the following reason. If you have a database and it has data, then the data that is queried and written to the database, right? And this is the whole part about NoSQL versus SQL. You want it to stay relationally integer, singular, atomic. And that means that if a partition arises, like here, you can either say, okay, you can still access the data, but I don't guarantee to you that the last bit of data is also the last bit of data written. Because in the meantime, somewhere else, somebody can write to the database and change the data, and you wouldn't know. Or you can say, if a partition occurs, I won't answer you, because I don't know for certain if the data is the last bit of data that was written. So then the computer should tell you no. There's a nice sketch about that. Computer says no. And I'd like to do a demo, but not on a computer. I'd like to have three volunteers, and you'll get a reward afterwards for your work, to demonstrate this principle in practice. Can I get three volunteers for it? No? Ah, well, I have at least one volunteer. It's very simple. I won't be asking silly questions. I'll just ask you to do something and answer some questions about these pieces of paper. Yeah, you'll be a database. Good. I'd like for you to stand here. I need at least one more node, preferably two. Come on, guys, this is going to take a lot longer to like this. Two. Then we'll do it with two. Doesn't matter.
You're going to the third one.
I need to be the one asking the questions. That's the problem. we'll do it with two. Okay. As I said, I'm a sales engineer. I make a lot out of a little for a living. So this is one bit of data, right? One byte. I put it in the middle, and these are my database nodes. Thank you for cooperating. So I can ask you, what is the number in the database at this point?
One.
Right.
Sorry?
Ah, with the microphone. Is this on? Yeah, functioning.
Yep.
Schön. Okay, so you said one in answer to
the question. One, yes.
Other node, would you please change the data to three? Okay, perfect. Well, can you now answer what the number in the middle is?
Three.
Good. So I have three nodes and they can all see the same data, right? Not anymore. Now we have a partition. Two of the nodes can't see the data anymore. And I'm going to ask the third node to put this number on top. Right? So now these two nodes don't know what the number is lying here, which is fine. But what are they going to do when I ask them what the number is?
One.
Okay, so this node still thought that the number was one, because that was in his cache, basically. Unfortunately, it's the wrong answer. So if this would be about a life and death question, then you'd have a problem. So, for instance, if this was the blood pressure of a patient, you might want to have the database tell the doctor, I don't know, in this case. So that is why in the partition system, there is a reason for not answering or telling the client there's an error, right? Also trouble is when I ask you now to change the number because you can't get to it, right? So how are we going to do this in a system where we have three nodes, but they each have their own local data? I had some dice with me, but I think that I must have misplaced them because they were the cache that I was keeping. But let's do it with your fingers. So I'm going to change it. I'm going to take the partitioning away. And now you can keep the number that is here on your fingers. So if it changes, right? You all have four, okay. This goes away, and now I'm going to do it differently. NoSQL in action. Can you please change the number to three? Don't know, because you can't see his fingers. This is a local cache. But you want to know the number. So now, if I go to you, can you please change the number for me to two? Right, your number changes to two. Two nodes, different numbers, three nodes, different numbers. But who is right in this situation? Trouble is that we don't know which of these nodes got the change first. There is no wall clock for all of these nodes, right? So what is the last number? This is what the problem is when you get a partitioning and you don't have consistency between nodes. It works because even if there's a partition, I can go to any node and get an answer. And this is what NoSQL systems do. And then afterwards, they're going to compare timestamps and everyone shares the same data and the data will combine again to one value in the end. And let's try that with the audience now. Thank you for your cooperation. For each of you.
Thank you.
A small token of my appreciation. Why am I going to change this now? I'm going to change this because I have a piece of paper here that is the central value, but that value is not visible to everyone because I'm shielding it with my body. So if you can please put fingers up, or the ones who can see the piece of paper can put fingers up what the number is on top. Right? Okay. And now the figure changes. So all the numbers change as well. But now I'm going to shield it. You still have the numbers 5 up. Right? I'm going to change it again. And now you can see the piece of paper and they can't. So the number changes. Okay. Where can you find the latest number? You still have 5. But if you look left to the side, there are nodes that have a changed value. I would like to have done this in a bigger audience. I've done this by Chinese whispers, right? Tell the person in the corner the new number and let them tell everyone, or by looking, change the number over. So what is happening is that changed data takes time to go from one end of a cluster or of the world to the other end. And in the end, everyone has the same answer. This is called eventual correctness, yeah? Eventual consistency. And that is what NoSQL is built upon. Why am I telling all this? Because I work for a company that sells support and tooling for a relational database, Postgres. I'm going to tell a bit about this because it gets to the point of open source software and cloud. Postgres exists longer than Linux. It was called Ingres before, but it became an open source project after Linux, actually, in 96. And it's been developed by a community since 96, and a community that is very big. It's not as big as the Linux community, but for an open source project, it's probably the second largest open source project in the world at this point. Supported by many companies, and it consists of a core team of 6 people. They are the board of directors, basically. And around that is a core team of developers of about 40. And around that, there are 2 other rings of several hundreds and several thousands of people who commit code, either directly or indirectly, to the database. What that means is that I told you already that many companies are earning money with open source. Well, many of these companies do that, but they also use databases for most of their functionality. Because, as I told you earlier, the mountains of data that are being generated need to be stored. And Google has one of the biggest history in storing data in several types of storage systems. And they ran into the problem of this partitioning very early on. And they created several solutions over the years. And in the end, they decided to cheat so hard that they invented time travel. They created a system whereby there's a global time clock for all their data centers based on GPS and atomic clocks. That is not feasible for many database applications out there. And what Postgres does is try to create a system where as many of these systems can work together in a relational way, but storing unstructured data. One of the hallmarks of NoSQL is that it mostly stores unstructured data. And we wanted that feature as well. And because Postgres is a system that has been evolved over the years to incorporate changes, it's very extensible. It can do this. And this means that Postgres is now suitable for big data. And that is important to you guys. Postgres, as Mr. Matzinger told me this morning, is being used for your student figures, for your number, for the numbers you get on your tests, for instance. So if you use a database right now, you might want to look into Postgres. If not for hacking the database and changing your numbers, then at least for learning from it. And what we've tried to do with Postgres is to integrate the NoSQL features that people want, being able to develop easily against it, but with all the features of a relational database, and that is where we are going the next few years. If you look at this, how many of you are programmers? All of you, I think. You've come across JSON data, at least understanding the term. And JSON data is data that is not structured. And this unstructured data is where our future lies. So, Postgres has changed with the needs. The way that NoSQL databases dice up data and share it across nodes is called sharding, and they do it very well. Relational databases don't do that, as I've shown with the demo just now. So how can you combine these? Well, you have to see that if you want to share data across nodes, you will have to have the infrastructure for it. And the sharding part is, and then I have to go back a slide or two. My slide set got corrupted this morning, so I had to recreate it, and I see I missed a slide. But what the PostgreSQL community has done is create a way for data to be projected from other databases into a central database and to be able to query it and work with it in a relational way. And that makes it possible in the future, with future Postgres releases, to do sharding in a relational database. And if you can, and you're coders, then I really invite you to come and look at the code and see if you can improve upon it. Because I think that the current generation of programmers has a very different way of looking at software. And that is where we are going. Okay. And but I work for a company, and this company is called EDB Postgres. And the company that is responsible for a large part of the development of Postgres, but we're also responsible for the development of a part on top of it, and that is Advanced Server. And the reason we've developed Advanced Server is to replace Oracle for certain loads. So there's Oracle compatibility inside of that version. I won't bother you with the details, it's mostly marketing. But the idea behind this is that we work together with the community to realize this. And this is something that I would like to explain as well. If you look at open source software right now, many of the developers of open source software are in the employment of a company. And the companies have their own needs, and the open source developers are catering to that. And we are doing the same. So we create all kinds of services and tooling around it to make that possible. But what I want to put up here for you to take in is that most of these tools, as you can see, are around the idea that you need a digital platform to store those mountains of data. And to be able to do that, you need certain features in your database. Well, some are better suited for NoSQL. So once you identify them, put them there, right? If you have very large amounts of ingest, large amounts of new data, you will want to put them into a NoSQL database. However, if the data needs to be consistent, then it's better to put it in a relational database and to project the NoSQL bits into it using these portals into the data. And they're called, in Postgres terms, they're called foreign data wrappers. There are other terms in other types of databases, but that's our term. And this makes the right top of the figure possible. It must say, is it readable? I don't think so, right? It's too vague.
Okay. Well, this is more
about marketing than technical. So what we've done is we created an interface for cloud that allows you to get this relational database and quickly roll it out across your infrastructure. So if you're going to do cloud with a relational database, make certain that you can do these kinds of things, because for you, as the end user, you otherwise will be struggling, right? Because setting up a database server is difficult. Even if it's a NoSQL database, a Mongo or any of the others, it's going to be very difficult to create big infrastructures from them if you don't know the deepest levels. And since integrity and consistency is hard, I suggest that you don't try to do that yourself. The same is with encryption. I hope you've all learned that you shouldn't do encryption yourself.
Right.
Which brings us to containers. My colleague of Microsoft, I think, told you a little bit about microservices and containers this morning. We do the same with Docker and Kubernetes, so the idea is the same, the tools are different, but it allows you to roll out databases at scale. Right. I'd like to have more of a discussion at the end about what you want to do with databases, because many of you already raised your hands in using them. What are the things that you think are going to be the most important to your database needs the next few years? Is there anyone who is run into trouble with their databases for relational data? None? It's all going fluently? Wow. Well, and you can ace them all then, right? You can give them all an A grade.
I don't know how many are running big databases in practice.
No, but even if you run a small database, you run into issues, either with connectivity or data that doesn't fit. Or the ones that are using NoSQL database, I saw a few hands here. What kind of data are you storing? NoSQL, JSON? Sorry? Didn't hear correctly. Where's the?
Financial data.
So I hear back here that there's mostly financial data, and this is your personal data or company data?
No, different companies.
Okay. And what are you running into when you try to store that?
Most times it's an issue with importing or exporting the database.
Okay, so that's the practical part. But you don't run into issues with the response was that he's running into issues with loading and exporting data.
Performance problems.
And you've looked at different solutions?
Yes, we have many different databases in our company. Oracle, SQL, DB2.
Yes.
It's always the same. So.
Okay, but those are very practical problems with the data just being out of bounds. But that is not the same as trying to get relational data into a NoSQL kind of array for the reasons that you stated, that it's difficult to get the data to agree with each other. Because what we see in practice in companies is that they start using NoSQL databases, and then in the end, it all blows up in their face because the relational part was what kept their data in one type, basically, so in one view. And with NoSQL, you get all these silos, and that is the risk that you run with cloud databases. But this is all one system, I think. that you're talking about, or are there multiple notes there? No multiple notes. Okay. Well, I'm at the end of my slideshow. I want to thank you for being here. I'm going to make place for the next speaker. It's 4 o'clock. So I'd like to thank you for your attention and time. And if you have questions, my contact details will be here. I'll be leaving my card. You can contact me afterwards. Thank you.